and will using other games. And that opened up a lot of what I do. And then this concept of gamification came along, and that's really interesting for me because it's a marriage of two interests, games and professional learning and communities. So I'm looking at how you can use gamification techniques to build community, whether that's a cadre of students or a professional learning community or community within any kind of teaching practice, so or a community with students. So that's me.
Cool. Now, you've also been involved in Second Life and Virtual Worlds, I think.
Yeah. Well, Quest Atlantis in itself was a game within a virtual world. So, yeah, I was involved in a lot of work in Second Life, mostly, again, communities of practice development more than games. And I think that's a distinction people need to make. Second Life is not a game. It's an environment. It's no more a game than, say, a park is a game, but you can play a game in a park. So Second Life is an environment that allows you to do many things, of one of which may be build or play a game. And that's there's been a lot of confusion over the years, people calling virtual environments games when they're not necessarily that at all. They may be something completely different. But you can build a game in them. So, yes, Second Life, OpenSim, Minecraft, a number of Quest Atlantis, and I work with students around the world in Quest Atlantis in what we call the Student Congress, which is a world built by students where the actual game missions inside it were also built by students. So that was a really interesting insight into what happens when you hand it to all the creative tools over to the kids.
Mm-hmm. So why don't we have the students introduce themselves? I'm going to see if I can phone Peggy, and meanwhile meet my students, and I know they have some questions for you. So Alex, why don't you
okay. Hi, I'm Alex Ross. I'm in the NLIS program, and I'm an archivist.
Hi, I'm Marcy Lewis. I'm also in the program. It's my second year, and I'm a librarian.
Hi, I'm Ashley Nolan. I'm a first semester MLIS student.
I'm Beth. It's my third semester, and I'm interested in archives and digital archives.
I'm Lauren. It's also my third semester, and I'm currently a children's
librarian. I'm Pippin. This is my third semester, and I'm interested in academic libraries.
Cool.
Why don't you ask a question while I try to read to Peggy?
I'll start. I loved your statement. I read, I guess it was your blog, and it was your most recent post, it was whatever was on the front page, and you made a comment about students wanting to level up to greater responsibility when you give them the chance. And I wondered if you'd seen that responsibility and that care for each other take place outside of the community online and changes in the kids because of what they were learning online.
That's a tricky question for me in that I actually deal with mostly with the kids in the online context because I'm not actually in classrooms, but I can certainly tell you what teachers report, and I can tell you one story from my Quest Atlantis experience. I was working with a school here in Australia in the very early days of using Quest Atlantis, and these grade 6 students were nearing the end of their school year, and they were asked to write, to create a picture book that they would pass on to the school library for other kids to read of something that was important to them in that grade 6 school year. So something that they thought they would take with them leaving the school. And one of the teachers phoned me up and said, I think you have to come and see this book. And it was written by a child who had barely written a sentence, very, very poor literacy skills, and really a child who was struggling at school. And his story was, and it was a picture book with several sentences in it, not a great deal of work, but for him, monumental. And his story was that a strange woman came to their school and showed them this game, Quest Atlantis, and hello, I'm the strange woman. He went on to say how he was really unhappy in the playground and he'd been picked on by a lot of kids, and he learnt in Quest Atlantis that it wasn't him, that he could have friends and that he could have positive relationships with other people. And the teacher said not only was the book a clear statement of something this child had found in the online environment, but that he was also better learning to be more resilient because he had a positive experience.
That's really interesting. So
that story to me is saying, kids can be building confidence, and we saw this a lot in Massively Minecraft, which is a server I was involved with for kids, where children who weren't finding, as Peggy would say, finding their tribe at school could be finding it online. And in very subtle ways, they take the confidence and the resilience they build in that space back into their face-to-face world. But it's not like you're going to have some monumental change overnight for kids. But I certainly find when I work with children, if you make very high expectations of positive behaviour from them, they always measure up to it. They want to. And in games like Quest Atlantis and Massively Minecraft, the reward for kids in leveling up in either of those environments was greater responsibility. And they hungered for that. Who would figure? It wasn't like trinkets or rewards or, you get to wear the Atta Girl badge. It was becoming a moderator on the system or becoming, having greater responsibility in your play. There may have been access to design tools, but then also with that came the responsibility of being a designer.
But that doesn't actually surprise me. It seems to be kids want to be grown-ups, right? They do want the responsibilities. So that makes perfect sense to me, but that's also an environment, the online environment, where we can give them those things. I mean, you can't hand up a third grader a knife and leave them on their own with it, but you can certainly hand them a tool online and let them work with it in a way that you couldn't. So that does resonate for me. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and to add to that, lots of schools are finding if they run a Minecraft server, if it's multi-age, that it doesn't matter if you're a third grader or a sixth grader. You can invent yourself in there, and if you're technically very capable or you shine in certain ways, you can be the leader in that. You can leave behind that hierarchy of the grades. And we found that in Quest Atlantis too, because our teacher avatars were no different to our student avatars. So what happened was kids wouldn't know you were a teacher till they chatted with you. And in my first year in Quest Atlantis, you would say to kids you were a teacher and they'd run away. Physically, their avatars would run away. But in later years, what we found was that you just became another person, a human being to converse with. And kids would run into me and say, oh, who do you teach here? Your kids coming online? When will they be on? Oh, we'd love to meet some kids from Australia. What's the weather like there? We hear you've had a change of government. And, you just became another person to converse with. So that horizontal learning space that you can create, free from the hierarchy, is another really powerful thing that happens in these social online games. I'm not talking necessarily about playing other kinds of games, but certainly social online games like Quest Atlantis, like Minecraft, like building something perhaps in OpenSim, building a community in that sort of space, or any of those sorts of games.
Did you see Eric Schillinger's blog this week, Ron? Do you know?
I do know him and I follow, but I haven't caught up with him this week, no.
I may have this not quite right. I didn't read it as carefully as I should have, but he discovered something about his son recently. He'd been reading his son was involved, I believe it was Minecraft, and his son had been creating a huge YouTube channel on tutorials for Minecraft. Eric had no idea, but he discovered this library of tutorials, not realizing that his son is like 9 years old, had produced videos and taken upon himself. He just developed himself the agency that he was going to teach the world how to do these various different granular tasks. And when his father discovered it, he was so impressed. This is real independent thinking. It's creative. And it's all about that world. And I just thought that was fascinating. We just discovering another side of your own child. So, I don't know.
Yeah, that's pretty true. We saw in massively Minecraft and other activities I've been involved with, as soon as kids learn something they feel is very powerful, the next step is to want to teach it to somebody else. And much of their learning in these games is based on YouTube. And I had a discussion this week with people about how kids now have YouTube heroes related to Minecraft, people who are run tutorial channels and you know, there are mega stars in Minecraft related to their YouTube tutorials and the channels that they've created. And they're all ages, and kids probably don't even know what age they are. They have usernames and pop names and have become the celebrities for children that maybe movie stars are for other people. But certainly, yeah, lots of kids will create their own how-tos of the things they think are important to know. And interestingly, we've run a lot of professional sessions for teachers with kids where the kids were the mentors on those sessions. And I think one of the things we have to learn to do in our teaching is to learn more like the kids in the same way as the kids do. We had a kind of apocryphal example in a PD session in Minecraft where one of the teachers was asking about skins because all the students had didn't have the standard avatar. They had all their own. So They'd gone and got skins or created skins for their avatar. And do people understand what I'm saying by skins on an avatar? I just need to double check. Anyway, and so they were asking, so where do you go get it? How do you get a skin? What do you do there? And one of the kids just, bluntly replied, "Don't you know how to Google?" As in, that was a really non-question to them because they wouldn't be stopped by not knowing something. They just jump onto Google, look for it, jump onto YouTube, look for a video that'll demonstrate it to them, and then dive in and tinker with it until you get it right. That attitude, teachers have to take that on board much more than they do now to be able to teach this generation of kids.
I think there is a learning curve in a lot of virtual worlds. I think for me, Second Life, I literally hit the wall a whole bunch of times. I felt bullied there. My clothes weren't right, and that I needed to go shopping. I think Peggy took me shopping. and then I had a student who, he knew I was real. I was doing professional development. I wasn't just, well, I was playing. But I'm playing in a community of practice, and I was doing speeches in Second Life, but I didn't feel like I felt like I couldn't get out of the newbie outfits, and I thought that people were looking at me funny because I was wearing a newbie outfit, and then I had this student who was a bit autistic. And he was looking at what I was doing one day, and he said, Dr. Valenza, your hair is not very good at all in Second Life. And then he got me a present. He shopped and did some screenshots, and he said, which one would you like? And then he took me into the shop, and we got the hair, and I had some Linden dollars. But it was funny. It was easy when I had a guide, and I guess I was afraid to admit that I needed one early on. and that was interesting. I also found it was so interesting that presenting was possible, that my worlds could collide in that way, that my library world could enter Second Life, and I could present as me there and meet all sorts of different people. I think you do maybe need to define skin, Ron. I don't think that everybody knew. But anyway, that was a little random. Okay.
No, I think a lot of what you're saying is very true. I was involved, I invited a teacher into the Virtual Worlds Best Practice Conference, which is run in Second Life. And it's a fantastic conference every year. It's free, and you know, lots of people come in to learn about virtual worlds and projects going on around the world. But I had invited this new teacher in, and the first day she was on her own, because I was presenting myself and you know, I didn't have enough time to devote to her. And the second day I caught up with her and I said, well, how did you find it yesterday? And she said, well, you know, I really felt like I'd been dropped in a foreign country without a dictionary, and you know, like I really didn't get what was going on. And although there were, people had set up sort of manuals of what to do, it wasn't immediate enough and didn't answer her direct questions. So the second day, I just took her around with me, and we went to presentations, and I showed her how to do things, and we just hung out. And it was a total turnaround. So for her, that was a really meaningful experience. But you're very right. You know, you've got to have a guide. You've got to have a mentor, whether that's a student or another teacher or whoever, if this is all new to you. And part of the reason I think I never had a bullying experience in Second Life was that I only ever hung out in professional community spaces. So I didn't join the random open Second Life spaces, and I was involved with Lindy McEwen in her professional learning spaces, and many of the ones run by Bernard Jean Porter and, you know, fantastic people like that. And the actual norms of those spaces were so positive that I never had a bullying experience. Touched on one once when a TV program CSI ran a Second Life an attachment to an episode of CSI, and so you could go into the world at the same time the program was running and be engaged as part of the storyline. And that was a little eye-opening because it was general public space, and it was a lot harsher and more mean-spirited than what I'd experienced being in professional spaces. So it kind of like, it's like where you hang out. If you go to any city, you know, there are safer and not so safe spaces to go to. So, but you're right. I think having a mentor.
We appreciate the New Jersey reference coming all the way from Melbourne.
So, yeah.
I wonder also, and I want to get to the students' questions. Did you get a chance to look at the students' questions?
I didn't.
We can read them for you. You may have, yeah. But I wonder also, how active is professional development in virtual worlds? Is it something we should be thinking about as professionals and as we build communities of practice? Is it vibrant, and is it the future? Not everybody here will be going into K-12 education. In fact, very few of us will be. But what are you seeing relating to the communities of practice that you work with and training and learning in professional spaces?
I'd say Second Life was actually, as a professional learning tool, was probably at its height, you know, 4 or 5 years ago. And I am seeing a resurgence of that for professional learning. I know ISTE, a number of different communities gave up their land because they weren't seeing as many people interested. That being said, if you're not talking K-12, I'm seeing some really interesting community space designs in, say, the professional world, where people are able to come in and practice working team, for instance, in a specific aspect or practice of a workplace. And so that level of professional identity and community building is really, but more niche, less large, less on the massively side of things, and more catered directly to particular workplaces. So in knowledge management activities or particular business practices or team building activities. One which I saw when I was at the Serious Play conference was very interesting because they built an environment where people can come in and work as a team to complete a number of challenges in this virtual world. It's built in Unity, which is a really beautiful design and development tool. And within that, and this program is actually built by not just game designers, but it has psychologists working on the project. And they're able to bring people in to do these team activities and to then analyze their capacity to work as a team, that particular group of people, whether that's a global group who are distributed places about the globe, or a team of people who are in a co-located workspace, but be able to look at them working on challenges as a prospective team. So it's almost trying on being a team before you go into the team in a workplace, or extending the amount of time they spend as a team beyond their standard workplace responsibilities. So I think there's some really interesting things in those kind of smaller spaces. As I said, I think Second Life is getting a resurgence, and a lot of people have built open sim environments for K-12 to have school communities, and that's been very popular. Is it going to be the workplace of the future? I know IBM has done a lot of work in virtual world professional learning and probably leads the way. You want to look at the research work of a person named Phaedra Boindris, who is absolutely brilliant and has done a lot of work on virtual worlds and games with IBM. I don't know that it's necessarily the future, but I think it's part of whatever we'll be doing as our virtual world experiences, as our learning experiences professionals.
Let's see if the students have any questions. Is anybody monitoring the Padlet or have access to Padlet?
Yes.
But feel free to ask any questions just based on what I'm talking about, of course.
Or if you want to comment, I'd love to hear what you're thinking and what the areas you're thinking this might apply, or let's make this more a conversation.
Well, I was struck by the story you told about the little boy who, you know, found a community in the virtual world. And it just seems to me that the more different communities that can be created, either in the real world or the virtual world, the better for children, so they can find the one that's the best fit for them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and a lot of people say, oh, well, that's just the virtual world. Well, kids just want to live in the virtual world, then not the face-to-face world. And you'll see there I made a distinction. I don't say real world and virtual world because it's all real.
Okay.
So virtual and face-to-face, or virtual and physical, is a much better distinction because I met Joyce online long before I met her physically. I met Peggy online and even went to stay in her house before I met her physically. And the day I was going to stay with her, she couldn't get home in time, so she just messaged me and said, look, here's where the key is, let yourself in, make a cup of tea, I'll be home in half an hour. And, you know, it doesn't get more real than that. So I think we have to stop making this real virtual distinction. It's all real, but some of it's physical, some of it's online, and we're going to interact in lots of different ways. But I was going to say something else in relation to what we were just saying. I remember once talking to Kurt Bonk, who's a lecturer at Indiana University, and another really brilliant person you may want to look at, who does a lot of blended learning teaching. But he was very big on creating a community of practice in his course. And I said to him once, but you create it, but all the other courses they do don't. How does that benefit students if they're getting it in this space and not in others? And he said, well, every time a student gets an experience, a successful experience of being in a community, it raises their demand for that in the next space. So every time a student learns, has positive relationships, whatever spaces we put them in, it raises their want to have those kinds of positive experiences. And whether that's in the virtual space or in the playground. For that little boy, the fact that the playground might have been a place of friction meant less to him when he discovered he could have friends and be a leader in another space. And that's got to be adding to a child's psyche, to their, their resilience. And that's the big word of, I'm pretty sure in America, but I know it is here in Australia, we've got a generation of kids who aren't as resilient as they should be.
Any other comments?
I guess one thing that I was wondering, do certain game genres or game platforms, do they offer more affordances than others, have you found? Like, do certain ones work better in the school setting than other ones?
I only look, most of my work is in social games, so that's my preferred space because I'm all about identity and community. But, there are lots of different games that work that are really brilliant. There's a game out of University of Washington, Zoran Popovich is developing, called Refraction. And it's a really interesting game looking at math concepts related to fractions. But the system has great deal of artificial intelligence built into it. So when it sees a pattern in your errors or your answers, it offers you a different pathway through the content. So the game itself is learning you as you're playing it. And I think that's massively powerful for kids learning in game spaces, and it's got a lot of very high quality research behind it. It's been trialled by schools across America. So that's not a social game, but a game with a great deal of that takes advantage of the capacity of programming and big data that can be used. So and the game itself is learning from the people using it. So they're collecting big data and able to enhance the possibilities of that game for each learner. So I find that massively exciting in terms of a math game. But, good old-fashioned Oregon Trail has been a fantastic game in its history in the United States. And similar games here in Australia.
I guess I keep wondering when I was almost embarrassed to bring that up because I think that was the first 5 1/4-inch disc that I was so attached to in education, and it was so powerful. And I don't think I've seen anything that was a game changer in that very simple way since then. And I think of all the games that were introduced and bought as turnkey kind of solutions for learning math and for learning history since then. And why was that so much more powerful than anything that, in my personal experience in the school, that we brought in since? I'm not Peggy, and I didn't have this rich World of Warcraft culture. I just watched as different administrators brought in equally poor solutions over the course of those 15 years. I don't know why was that so powerful and so few others.
Which one is that? Because I missed that somehow.
Oregon Trail was an adventure where you decided who you were going to be. You could pick a character. Alex seems to know
it. Yes, my kids played it. and you were traveling across the West, and you had to, you know, you shoot a buffalo to survive, or you had to, you know, all of these different survival.
Swim the river, ford the river.
Very simple game,
and you could get, you could hunt bear.
Yeah.
Sometimes you
die. Yes, sometimes you die.
Yeah.
But then, to another point, I have three children. My son loved Oregon Trail, and my daughters didn't play it that much. So I wonder, are you seeing different...
And there was Carmen San Diego, too.
Yeah, different games appealing to different kids, or are boys playing more than girls? Are you seeing any differences there?
Well, take the first point. In Quest Atlantis, we found that it was probably a third. A third of the kids actually excelled in Quest Atlantis. And teachers were reporting, strangely enough, I was really saddened for our profession when a couple of teachers said to me, I'm really worried about this game because I'm not seeing the kids who are normally on the top. You know, different kids are rising to the top. And they thought that was a bad thing. You know, I think that's an indictment of our profession if we're, you know, setting our ways of thinking, you know, X child always excels because, you know, different learning environments should have different kids lit up by them. So we found a third of them really absolutely excelled, and in particular kids like kids on the spectrum, quite a few kids who would never have the chance to shine. Really were excited by it. A third of the kids would do it because they were good kids and they'd do what the teacher asked them to do and they'd enjoy it, but it wasn't floating their boat. And a third of the kids, this probably really wasn't a learning environment that was going to work for them. But I don't think we should not play games for that reason. I think we just have to see them as additional things on our palette to offer kids and, you know, realize that it won't float every kid's boat, but there are kids we're not reaching in traditional methods and we're quite happy to leave them behind with what we're doing. So if we change it up a bit and use some games. As to the girls and boys question, I would have said, if you asked me that question several years ago, I might have said yes, but watching Minecraft, and you use the term game changer, Joyce, it really is. We see girls equally excited by Minecraft as boys. And not in the way that I've heard some people report that girls like to build and boys like to program. We see equally girls and boys wanting to do all of what Minecraft has on offer. But it has lots on offer. So I think it does... captivate many kids, whether you want to build things, you want to code things, you want to, you know, to go far in terms of modding, changing things on the system, or you just want to build a house and survive the night. There are a great deal of ways you can engage in Minecraft. I did find in Quest Atlantis the girls engaged more in conversation, but I think that's changed as kids have become more able in social online games. So, I mean, we have kids in Minecraft as young as 4 who are learning to write, and they're very quickly learning to read and write because you have to communicate in the game to get on. So I think... it is changing. Girls and boys will play equally. I think my initial thing with girls is they'll come in and say, okay, what can I do here? What can I create here? What can I invest here? And initially, that's what girls will want to do. Boys in Quest Atlantis, we would see run around and want to slay something. Now, I don't know that that's naturally... the difference between boys and girls, I think it's perhaps the difference in their existing game experiences. And so, you know, they bring some of the experience they've had in other games, and lots of boys play first-person shooters. That also is changing. I mean, the game industry says now that, women make up most of the higher majority now of game players, and that's because of the variety of games that have come onto the scene. Whether that's Words with Friends or Candy Crush Saga, the world is changing in terms of games.
That brings up a whole bunch of things. Ashley asked earlier about the people's dismissing or fear of violent video games. Do you have any thoughts on that? You brought up the first-person shooters. Are they damaging in any way, do you think?
Well, I think like anything else, too much of a good thing. I'll tell a story from the Games in Education conference 2 years ago. There was a teacher there did a virtual world. His kids were doing live role play of a piece of Greek poetry and heroic poetry, and they were doing it live in Call of Duty. So their characters were playing out the story while he was, one of them was the narrator to the piece of the story. And the story itself is very violent. So, you know, like poetry was violent, stories were violent. So violence is a component of our human thing. So I don't think that we should avoid all violence, but I personally don't play. I have played some of these games, and I don't enjoy them. I don't know that they're harmful. I watch kids playing Call of Duty, and in a room, three of them on a server, lots of conversation going on, lots of play, but they understand the difference between that and picking up a real gun. World of Warcraft has multi-millions of players around the world. Call of Duty has probably billions of players around the world. And we're not seeing all of those people act out in violent ways. That being said, it's all about balance. Kids in Minecraft can be violent. There's TNT. You can blow things up. You can kill other people. I think it's something we don't need to fear-monger about. And I think there's more to be said for kids and their particular personalities and whether they may need more positive activities in their life. If you were spending, 10 hours a day playing Call of Duty, then I think you're really in a problem space for that. But if that doing anything 10 hours a day would be problematic. And so I don't think violence is the big nasty everyone thinks it should be. Just to tell you, I had, like, from Quest Atlantis, I had a couple of kids who from Canada who did some fantastic work for me in the Student Congress. And as a reward, I gave them an account in Minecraft. And I also gave their parents an account in Minecraft. And these were children from deeply religious backgrounds. Now, My Quest Atlantis had no violence in it. You couldn't. There were no weapons. You couldn't kill anybody. It wasn't part of the game. And I was a little concerned that parents would look at Minecraft and shun away from it. And they really, watching their kids play and talking with their children, they got it. They got the idea that threat was part of the game. And, that's part of the excitement. Now, kids can play Minecraft in either creative or survival. In creative, all the threat is turned off. So there are no monsters. They can't harm you. You can just build. Or you can switch the server to creative, to survival, where the threat is present. And as it gets dark, the monsters are going to come out and you can die. And you ask kids which mode they'd naturally rather play, they'd rather play survival because that's part of the game. That's part of the juices flowing for the game. It's a tricky question. And I'm really not a fan of a lot of the people who are like, heavy metal music's going to turn your kids into, shooters in schools or violent games are going to. The fact that these kids play, I think a lot of these things are coincidental rather than show causality. So that's my opinion on it anyway.
Thanks, Bron. We're going to have to give these guys a break in a minute, so maybe we'll do one last question or one last comment. Anybody? One of the things I saw years ago in Virtual Worlds was actual library reference questions. I think it was at a college in Appalachia, and I haven't seen anything else like that since. I probably should be searching it out, but I wonder if that's part of the library experience for the future. It was very appealing. They built a beautiful library environment, and they had very friendly reference librarians with very cool library outfits. But I don't know if that still exists.
I think a lot of virtual libraries still exist there, and people are still building them.
Maybe if you name one, I will search it out for future reference here. Are you aware of which ones that are still out there? The Library of Congress would have had a space at one point, but I don't know if they still do.
Yeah, I'm not sure. You might want to talk to Michelle Jensen about that. I know she built a virtual library in our Plain community.
That's right. She was with us in Brisbane, right?
Yeah. She built a virtual library in our Plain community, just looking at what would you want to do in the virtual space that you may not be able to do in the physical space. And I think that's an important point, is not to just replicate what we already have. Mary Ann said, you know, recently her kids wanted to build a Minecraft school, a program to teach people how to use Minecraft outside their school. And they automatically built a school that looked like a school, that physically, where in the virtual world you can have it look like anything. The architecture can be of any form, but you can also afford very different things. So, you know, like, I think that's where it gets interesting, is what can you do differently, or how can you enhance the library experience by what you offer in the virtual space, by the affordances of virtual tools. And I think that's some really interesting things.
I'm thinking about that for the next few years. I love the idea of that. I mean, I think we were looking at it in very simple ways, not in really there is no box kind of thinking. You know, we were thinking about how people weren't afraid to ask questions of people because they may not be judged as not knowing things. But that's so inside the box. I love the idea of really rethinking what a library might be about in a virtual space, or how service can be completely different.
Well, if you think about ISTE, had in their virtual world space, they had docents, it was their job, you signed up for 2 hours a fortnight or a week or whatever, and you would be in a space just to help new people, you know. So someone would land in the world, you'd say, hi, are you new here? Is there anything I can help you with? How can I show you around? Well, you can have librarians 24/7 who don't have to physically go to a space, you know, so you can distribute the responsibility for being in a space beautifully. And that was one of the key features of the ISTE community, was that docent program. And they became a really tight-knit community of practice themselves. But many people said, you know, like, what made the difference of landing in ISTE Ireland was that you would always be greeted by a real person. So it wasn't just a digital character. A real person met you and asked you if you wanted help. And they had the time to walk you around somewhere or point something out to you that might be of interest to your particular needs. So, you know, that kind of, you can't physically do that in a physical library, but lots of things you could do that in, you know, on the social side in a virtual library space.
Mm-hmm. That's exciting. I'm hoping that we can get back and build. I guess the problem that I had with that space was I wanted to do more there, but I found for me everything took much longer than I wanted to, and I didn't have the resilience that we describe in terms of building understanding the norms of the community as well as I should. And I think and you described the idea that some people do some things well and other people do other things well. Here was the first time, like I've always been an A student, and here was the first time I really hit the wall. And I wasn't as graceful as everyone else. But what it did for me was understand the barriers that learners face who have different talents and what learning feels like when it's hard. And that was good. I always thought that was a good thing, and it made me really much more empathetic in other areas of my life, because I have to tell you how profound it was for me that I just couldn't get over some of the barriers.
Oh, I know exactly what you mean. I equally had the experience of someone taking me shopping because I was giving a big presentation online, and I said, "Oh, look, I felt I looked too newbie to present." And she said, "Oh, well, let's go shopping. What would you like?" And you know, took me places. And, you know, it's that human connection is brilliant and real, very real. But I agree that, you know, but the tools are getting better. Second Life, I mean, you can download an entire space now and then adapt it for yourself. You don't have to build from the ground up. And I think that's the exciting thing. In Unity, for instance, if you want to build, you know, a story in a medieval castle for free, you can download the whole medieval castle. Well, then you can get on with building your resource or adapting that medieval castle to what you want. You don't have to have, you know, the full suite of designers and graphic artists to do everything. So I think the tools are getting friendlier, and that's something a lot of people said about Second Life, is that the learning curve to design in it was too tough. And people like Lindy McEwen designed, really adaptable spaces and then gave them away. So I think, you know, there is the design community behind all these spaces is also very generous.
Well, I think we're going to have to say goodbye and get the break in today for our class, but I'm so grateful that you joined us. Ron, who are you on Twitter for my class to get in contact with you?
Just Bron St, BronST.
Great. Well, shall we
And if you have any follow-up questions, don't hesitate to ask later on down the track, or if you want to meet up and explore a world or a space, I'm happy to do that as well. And I'm sorry Peggy couldn't get on, but she may have had the same technical problems I was having. I kept getting server error.
I wonder about that. I think we're going to be looking at her World of Warcraft article because I really want them to hear that story as well. Maybe we can arrange to have her visit another time too. Anyway,
okay.
What time is it there?
It's just coming on 8 a.m.
Well, thank you for waking up early for us. We really appreciate it. Thanks a million, Bron.
Nice meeting you all. Good luck with your studies.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Bye. You too. Okay. Bye.